Hi guys, Harry Sundai here, letting you know that there's a apparel company that supports the game that you love. It's called There Is Only One Football.com, guys. They've got all sorts of stuff, from caps, t-shirts, water bottles, all sorts of accessories, even for your mobile phone, all that sporting stuff you can wear anywhere you want to wear it, guys. That's right. And don't forget the website it's on, thereisonlyonefootball.com.
Comes. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, from the deeps of despair, from the country that wants the game to grow. Australia is the day, Australia is the country. It's party time on Footballers, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Don't show me that knife. The cup of life, this is the one. Now is the time, don't ever stop. We shouldn't know, gotta be strong. We shouldn't know, right from the top. And when you feel the heat, the world is at your feet. No one can hold you back if you really want it, Carlos. I see it in your eyes, you want the cup of life. Now that the day's here, you're gonna get it. Do you really want it, Tony? Do you really want it, there, Mark? Angela, do you want it? We go. Ali, 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 go, 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 Ali. That's right, guys, show the red card. Show the red card, it's coming. We've got red cards in this country, unbelievable. That's not a red card, Carlos. What are you doing, mate? I'll tell you what, guys, it's our way, the high legend. It's our way, the high way. It's our people, the passion. It's our country, Australia. We want the game to grow further. Good evening, everybody right there. Good evening, everyone right now, guys. Good evening, everyone right now. We'd like to mention right now, all the way from northern New South Wales, our special guest for tonight, guys. Mr. Mark Trenter, Joe, thank you for joining us, Mark. And of course, we got the Socceroo dad, Mr. Tony Goodwin from South Australia. That's it. That's what we're going to pray for. That's what we're praying, guys. It is Ramadan, so pray like that, Carlos. It's fine. So right now, guys, all the way from Sydney, of course, Mr. Carlos Bielli, Planet Football New South Wales.
Thank you.
And of course, the man from Uncle, the lookalike of the game, the James Bond of the game, Mr. Of course, you know who it is, guys. Your friend and my friend, Mr. Angelo Picca. Boys, and Mark, that's what you call an intro to a show. You know what I'm saying? So there you go. And now, Mark.
Harry,
go on. Yes. Carlos wants to say something.
Can I make a request that you become a Taylor Swift song next week? You know, we need a bit of a... It's the same song for a couple of years. What do you do up there?
I think that is
Pink. Pink, raise your glass to be a good soccer song.
I have some songs. We can't. It's something called "We Can't Be Beaten." Or if it's
I'm thinking you could change the repertoire if it's for the
game in Australia. It's "Highway to Hell." That's what I could sing that one too. There you go. But the thing is, guys, thank you for joining me tonight, guys. It's all happening tonight in this country. It's been a massive week for the game. It's a massive day, a massive week, whatever. But I tell you what, you've got a massive story, and you're wearing one of your former teams there, Mark. One of your former teams. I'm wearing the first team you played for. You'll see it on the replay, and you're wearing the other one that you played for, KB United.
Exactly, yeah. So, I'm City Hakar, brought to Australia, and I played four seasons and had a stint at KB United.
Fantastic. So the thing about that is that you came to this country via Bromwich Albion. You, what we call this country, it's sort of like, why do we say this? It's the, of course, you came out here. It is the last, the first national competition in this country, and it was the last, what do they say, the last place you could come to play the game itself after being so many different sports here. It's not funny, of course, Mark, you know that. We call this the last frontier of the game in this country. Of course, you would have known that for sure when you came off the plane.
Yeah, you're right. I came in 1978. I think the National League started in 1977.
Yes, yes.
I was identified. I had quite some serious injuries, ankle reconstructions, and a Swedish surgeon came over to West Bromwich Albion to do these operations on me. And to cut long story short, I was an apprentice for 2 years, a pro for 2 years. And Johnny Giles, the ex-Leeds boy player, signed me as a professional. And Ron Atkinson came in, took his spot, flicked me to Australia for a one-year contract. But it was that good, and Frank Lowy decided he wanted to sign me for 3 years. So, I didn't go back, basically.
When you were with Frank Lowy, of course, our dear friend Frank Lowy, we all love him, of course, in this country, but we got to go to the politics of that. But was he the president at the time when you came here?
Yeah, he sure was, yeah.
And he looked after you quite well, from what I've heard.
Extremely well. It's like a prodigal son.
We wish he was before he left, but that's okay. But the thing is, Mark, it's that and then how many seasons you played at Hakoa?
I played in three grand finals. I played 78, 79, 80, and 81. And that was it. And I had a little stint, eight games at KB United, did a transfer with Kenny Bolden. Oh. But then Eddie back after eight games and said, "This is silly. You two boys should be playing together." And we went on to play a couple grand finals with Kenny Bolden, but I packed it in at 23, actually, and I had another reconstruction.
That's amazing. Absolutely.
You can have, but I certainly had lost.
So you went to of course after Hakawa to Newcastle KB United, and now the shirt that you're wearing, is that the away shirt, or that's the away shirt, isn't it, or was that the original shirt?
Do you know what? I'm not that sure. It's the original colours, and it's Newcastle United. Whether branded correctly or not.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm not sure. But it was from your colleague sent them.
Yes. It's a very they're very good quality shirts too. By the very good quality. I'm very surprised. I'm wearing the one that you wore as well when you came here. I'm wearing the Hakawa. Wait till you see the Hakawa on the replay. It's amazing. I've had that. A few people have bought one of these too, actually. So they've bought this one as well. And I tell you what, have you got any questions, Tony, for Mark?
It's I'm going to say Newcastle related. I wore my beloved Palace top, but it was the nearest thing I could find in Newcastle Jets when Craig played there. But here's a memory one for you. I didn't know that you actually helped look after Connor Chapman when he came to play in Newcastle back in 2011. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so at the time I was a member of Men of Football, and I was living on my own, and I figured that I would put my hand up to help simulate players coming into a new city, and rather than being treated like babies, have the bit of a street sort of authentic way about them and kind of keep an eye on them. But also I was there to run them around, and it was great. The connection, I just loved it, and do things like that today.
Carlos?
Excellent.
Yeah, well, Sydney, when you came, would be a large country town. What did you think of Sydney when you first came out? Did you think, oh, my God, what am I doing here after a long flight, very long flight?
Absolutely amazing. I think I've shared this before, but I was on a flight with John Cosmino. I didn't know him from Adam. Just happened to be unbelievable sitting next to him. He was leaving Arsenal and I was leaving West Brom. He was going to West Adelaide. Anyway, we become friends for life. And in fact, I was talking to John today, and it is incredible. I had a suit on and long permed hair, and he had a pair of thongs on, a pair of shorts on. And a bit overdressed, Australia, mate, you know. And anyway, John took my place in Sydney City Hakau after a few seasons. So yeah, so that was. And in answer to your question, living, the club put me in a hotel for 6 months at Bondi Beach, and it was just unbelievable. Fascinating.
Now, it sounds like you were treated like a king. What was it like living there, Bondi Beach, in a hotel?
Well, I was like a king. I had all my meals paid for, my accommodation paid for. I think I was
paying
$300 a game.
Oh, my God.
But, of course, after a while, they said to me, you have to work in this country as well. No, we can't keep on. I said, what?
Oh, my God. Of course, someone knows Cozzy over here too. Actually, Angelo, you probably know Cozzy, but this is the gentleman who was actually the Adelaide City CEO at one stage too. So you would have played against Adelaide City, Angelo.
Yeah.
Look, I know Cozzy very well, and I think Mark probably couldn't keep a secret. He told Cozzy how good it was at Bondi, because Cozzy's done the passion is surfing. And, of course, he was playing over there later, Uncle Mark, and he would have loved Bondi Beach, and I reckon Mark would have told him how good it was. And, you know, because I remember Cozzy played for West Adelaide in 78. Mm-hmm. They had a very successful year. I was only a kid, but, you know, I followed it with passion. And Cozzy then found himself playing over there at Hakoa later on, and obviously he loved the life, and he was a very flamboyant sort of personality. It always caught the attention of the media, which was good for the game. You know, like rightly or wrongly, he's a media man. You know, the media love him. You know, when he does controversial sort of like controversy or anything like that, I think it's anything that catches the attention is great for the game. And Cozzy's absolutely, he was fantastic, and so is he now as well. You know, when he's running a radio show with Don Ronaldo. But Mark's story is absolutely fantastic. I remember those first 2 or 3 years of the NSL. Everybody was excited about it right throughout the country. It was a fantastic time for football. You know, like, and of course, we know that 2 or 3 years before that, our great man, Rally Rasich, had conquered Germany, you know, for the first time in Australia, made history. And then 3 years later, we had the NSL, and Mark was part of that. And I remember Hakoa, you know, they were the strongest team in Australia. So congratulations, Mark. I think that was an era very significant for Australian football.
Thank you. Yeah.
Go on, Mark. And also, Mark, we had you might have played with a gentleman who, I forgot his name right now, you might have played with a gentleman who passed away about a year ago. He actually bought a Hakoa shirt as well.
Alan Kirsch.
Yes, Alan, what a sad story. And you would have played with him. What sort of player was he?
He was a tricky right back and very versatile player. And a great man, a great squad member.
Very sad. It was a sad day last year, I remember.
Yeah, very sad. Yeah, so coming from West Brom and playing up with Brian Robson.
Yes.
Of course, Manchester United in England. In fact, I caught up with him in Thailand. That was kind of cool. The fact that I played in Cyril Regis.
Go on.
Kind of a cool memory for me. But being in that professional environment, you're conscious of it. It never goes away. Mm-hmm. Now, being on the board of Northern New South Wales and involved in football and player development, etc., helps to reflect back when I was an apprentice professional, and the yeah, the culture.
Yep. And what I'll ask you is, what was it like you being an apprentice? You were an apprentice at West Bromwich Albion. You saw the professionalism in England at the time, and you came out to Australia, and your first training session, walking out of Hakoa, did you say to yourself, what am I doing here? What was it like the first training session? The grounds wouldn't have been as good as England's, that's for sure. But what was it like?
It was a bit unusual because the training session was at Wentworth Park.
Yes.
And I remember it's inside a dog track, and I was thinking, well, it's a bit odd. So, yeah, get it all the time.
But the other thing is, I do have something here right now from King Kenny Taylor. He remembers you, if you know King Kenny Taylor. He said, 1980, the 1980 final, Mark's battle with Pat Bannon. Can you tell us about that one?
Yeah, well, the Welsh generally get on with the Irish, but I've swung a few elbows.
Really?
Swung a few backs. It was good combat, actually.
Unbelievable. So, Tony, you got a question for Mark?
I was going to say, just talking about Connor Chapman earlier, were there any other players that you looked after besides Connor back in Newcastle days?
The boy that if I sound a bit vague, I had a massive day today and I had a cortisone injection into my hip joint.
Oh, sorry. Oh, boy.
This afternoon, so it's a bit distracting. I was expecting the pain to go away, but I don't know. But anyway, the boy that's Lebanese socceroo playing for City, Andrew Naboo.
Naboo.
So yep. He lived in my apartment and I rented my apartment out to him. So I had a lot to do with him and a lot of coffees and one-on-one discussions about his runs into the box and his timing and stuff like that. I found that to be very rewarding. That was great. I've probably forgotten that, to be honest, but there's a lot. Taylor Reed, for example.
Yep. Good bloke, Taylor. Still had the best church front I've ever seen, and that was not the AFL. That was against Melbourne Victory in a cup game. That's one of the best hip and shoulders I've ever seen.
Unbelievable, mate.
Under 15s, I made him captain when the Jets played in the Premier League in Sydney, the Youth League, and I was a coach of the under Gary Van Egmond's era. Yep. And although Gary's had a few different eras, and I was concerned about Taylor's heading of the ball, but I made him captain. I could see something in him, and of course we're friends today, and it's a great thing. Talking about that for a second, it's been roughly 19 years since the Jets youth have been playing in the, you know, with the Marconis and the Croatias and the Parramatta Eagles and the big league. So that's a kind of a big breakthrough, you know. So whilst you hear a lot of doom and gloom, there's a lot of good stuff going on in Newcastle. There really is. I hate to start talking about negative stuff, you know. Of course, traditionally speaking, Newcastle and its areas produce some of the best, and it's got a history like you wouldn't believe. I think that will return. I think it's on the turn. We've got a new CEO for Northern New South Wales, who's a football man. We've got a new coaching staff at the Jets. Stanton and the goalkeeping coach has been around the game for a long time. And a local boy that knows the landscape of Newcastle. And I think it will pay dividends as soon as we can get an owner, of course. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
You've got an Adelaide boy who was a Stamatolopoulos. He's doing exceptionally well, bagging in the goals over there.
Isn't he ever? He's come back with poise and finesse, and his runs are superb, you know. So he's knocking on the door, as you're saying, or inferring to the Socceroos. I'd be interested to see if he gets a game.
Exactly.
Excellent.
Now, Carlos, any more questions for Mark?
Oh, yeah. How has football evolved from your day to today, tactically and men management, player welfare? Can you take us through that journey when you look back?
Well, I mean the game is 100% quicker. You know, there's no way that the old NSL players, even if they think they could compete with with an A-League side today. No, they've got no chance. Honestly, I seriously believe. Whilst lots of the players back in the day had character and individualism, I don't think we'd compete for sure. The culture's changed in terms of, like, for example, the coach, Stanton, the coach of the Jets, he may well have a quiet word with one of the players, but he'd never broadcast it or try and embarrass the player because I guess, you know, we're all a bit sensitive these days, aren't we? So back in the day, you'd get shown up in front of the whole team if you did something wrong. But now, sure, I would point it out in a clever, strategic way. But it is concerning when you see players, you know, making the same mistakes, let's say, like giving penalties away or diving in the penalty box. I'd love to, as a spectator, hear what the coach thinks of that. I think, how on earth is he still playing, you know? So those areas, I don't know whether that answers your question, but we're a bit more tactful about the way we go about things. But I hope the message is getting across. Yeah, I hope the coaches are not missing it.
now, Mark, you're a director. You've gone into the, they say, the deep end. You're a director in the deep end. Is that right? When you get onto the board, you're in the deep end. You're always going to get messages and things all the time, what's happening with the league. So they call it Northern New South Wales Football Association. So why haven't they called it NPL New South, part of NPL New South Wales? Why haven't they amalgamated in making one association for the whole state?
Oh, blimey.
That's a big one, huh?
I think if you don't know, you don't know. I don't want to bullshit to you. But anyway, I'm the what do you call it? You got a chairman and you got a vice chairman. I'm the vice chairman of Northern New South Wales. And it's got over 80,000 members.
Gee.
And it's got zones that run their own CEOs and run their own boards. And it's got their own constitutions. Albeit we're trying to amalgamate things now and be a little bit more resourceful. I'm big on the subject of, wanting to know what our assets are, and with transparency, with a view to certainly not cutting things down, but with a view to helping share the assets and to maybe convert the assets into synthetic playing fields, for example. A lot of that goes on. It's difficult, it's complicated, and it does my head in. I don't think I'm intellectual enough board level to understand half the words even, but to be honest, I'm having a bit of success. One thing I'm proud of, that I chaired up the promotion and relegation. So we hadn't had promotion and relegation for 20 years. It didn't look like we were going to have it. I must say that's one area that I was like, I was never going to let that go. It just, to me, it's tradition, and it just needed to be in, and irrespective of all the, you know, there's some areas where you argue that, but generally speaking, without promotion, relegation, what's our game about, you know?
Well, this is exactly, and now I'll bring Angelo into that right now, because the thing is, Angelo was also an administrator as well of the game, and the thing is, promotion and relegation. He's directly in Italy now, in Naples, and he knows promotion and relegation through the Italian league. And of course, in the NSL, we did have some kind of relegation and promotion, and we did have something there. But the thing is, Angelo, and of course, Mark, you didn't have promotion relegation in that Northern New South Wales competition. That is crazy. Did they just want to keep it the same way it was, or they didn't want change?
These days you could murder someone and get away with it, and you can justify anything, but there's so many justifications. But sometimes I like to keep it very simple, you know. We don't have the tyranny of distance when you're talking against Newcastle, so what's the reason why you can't? So it just, every game then becomes a game of purpose, you know. It sells more chips, it brings more players, it brings more spectators to the game. Very basic stuff that, anyway, it's up and happening, and I'm kind of proud of that. Fantastic. We're having a look now, like a strong look, and it'll be unveiled in 2025 next season.
Good.
The, Junior Development League. Oh, that's yes. That's under huge scrutiny, and it's fair play to our CEO and the board. It's been driven, and there's going to be some great stuff come out of that. I can't go into it because it's in the process of getting announced.
Angelo?
Yeah, look, I think that Mark has actually touched on some really fantastic points. I mean, we're talking about the second tier competition now coming in, and the A-League, you know, like not having promotion relegation. I think Mark has touched on some really excellent points and valid points that should be shared with the A-League or the APL. You know, like when the second tier competition comes in, you know, you've got to have that promotion relegation for the main reasons that Mark has just mentioned. In South Australia, as Tony knows, we've had promotion relegation from NPL to second tier and second division, third division, and all that sort of thing, right up to amateur league, you know. So that's the sort of thing, that's the fabrics of the game that you need to have to actually help you grow the interest of the game right throughout Australia. Very much as similar as, you know, when this FA Cup came in Australia, the interest grew. And I think that promotion relegation is fundamental. And, you know, like hopefully the second tier competition will have it sooner than later, you know, and stop with this thing about thinking 5 years, 10 years. I mean, that's just ridiculous, because the teams in the second tier competition will have budgets from between 3 million and 5 million, and you don't just want to play in a second tier competition to stay there. I mean, you know, and to perhaps it'd be great to develop young players, you know, for a career path, you know, to have youth there and play there and sort of a step, you know, into the right direction to playing A-League. But promotion relegation, for the reasons that Mark mentioned, and he voiced his opinion with the administration there, Northern New South Wales, I think we need to have that with a second-tier competition. Just one thing, guys, I want to mention, and, you know, I don't want to forget about this, Steve Maxwell.
Oh, that was the next. That's exactly what I got, Angelo, right there. Right there. Yeah. I was going to ask you about that too now.
Had it on my mind too, mate.
Go for it, Angelo. Yeah.
I wanted to mention the late Steve Maxwell. Obviously, I had a chance to work with him when I was at Adelaide City, and he was more than just a footballer. Steve was he was actually a very strong sort of footballer, you know, physically, mentally, and very loyal. But I think, from my point of view, I was the marketing director at Adelaide City at the time during those, you know, successful years. From 86, I got up to 95, and Maxie was part of that team. And he never said no to any marketing, promotions, events, publicity, television. You know, I was obviously in charge of the media interviews and all that sort of thing. What I was trying to say is that he was so loyal to the game, and he knew that we need to have as much interviews and as much presence and vision of the players to the community. And he never, ever said no. He remained loyal right up to the end. I mean, he was coaching Sturt Lions recently, and a couple of years ago he had some heart problems, and I don't know what the cause of death was, but it actually brought tears to my eyes because I was so close to the Adelaide City players. I was talking to Aurelio Vidmar a couple of days ago, Tony Vidmar. You know, it's just a very sad day for football. To lose a player of the caliber of Steve Maxwell at the early age of 58.
Too young. And I remember watching him. He was so athletic as a player. The way he ran, he did things. Also at Marconi, I think at Marconi, they're also pretty saddened as well, because he played for Marconi for a few. How many seasons, Angelo, he played at Marconi? He played, was it two seasons or one season? I think he went back to Adelaide.
Yeah, I remember even Zoran Matic making a comment in the media. Zoran was always off the cuff when Steve Maxwell went to Marconi. He only played for 1 year, and then we took him back because Zoran said we gave Marconi a Mercedes-Benz and he's come in a Volkswagen. As a Volkswagen.
I never forget that
statement in the media, because I used to follow it passionately, but Maxie, you know, he was so affectionately, loved by all the players. Like, as you know, when he was playing, we had Robert Savica, Vidmar, Tony Vidmar. There's Milan Ivanovic, Bugs Niskus, Sergio Milta, Charlie Villani. I could go on and on and on. Joey Mullen, Carl Veit, of course, took his spot, and, you know, he came in a later stage. But, you know, Maxi was playing in that team. It was a stellar team. You know, it was a team that forced Eddie, the late Eddie Thompson, Les Schweinfluch, and of course, Frank Arrock to look to Adelaide for the national team players. And at one stage, as everybody knows, we had five or six in the first 11. And I remember Frank Arrock came to Adelaide, and Australia played in one of the teams from England. I can't recall the name. You know, you guys probably be able to help me. But in that game, Arrock fielded nine Adelaide City players, and Maxi was one of them.
A player that played alongside Archie Thompson at Melbourne Victory. His name slips my mind at the moment. They played dual strikers. Big lad. Anybody help
big
me there?
Big lad, Melbourne Victory.
Was he an Adelaide lad? I can't remember.
I thought he might have been from Adelaide, but he definitely played for Melbourne Victory, and he played alongside Archie Thompson for many seasons.
Okay.
I can see it,
But maybe was it Travis Dodd, Tony?
I can see his face, but I can't think of his name.
Big, strong striker, good touch, and
Besart Berisha.
Well, with him.
Besart Berisha?
No.
It was after him.
It was after him. Okay. Oh well. Okay.
No, I can't remember. Anyway, guys, in closing, I hate to be sort of like negative on today, because Mark's brought up so many great points. But Steve Maxwell, you know, to be remembered, and may he rest in peace. And he contributed so much to South Australia and Australian football. And, you know,
I always get these things happening from the oracle of the game. He always comes on. The oracles. Everybody, hail the oracle. Put your hand up, hail the oracle, boys. Carlos has done it. But listen to me, guys. This is what Mark. You said before that the A League's a lot better than the NSL. Now this has come from the oracle of the game. His name is Roger Sleeman. Let me read what he said to you. I disagree. The A League being better than the NSL. Soper, Catholis, Patikas, Kalanzis, Trimboli, Barnes, Mullen, Cosmina, Krinkovic. I could keep going. Jankovic, Digny, Rod Brown, David Lowe, and Terry Butler, just to name a few of that ran riot in the A-League. Unbelievable. All these players you remember just off the top of your head. He just mentioned an Australian full team, didn't he? Just about, you know that? Oh, my God. That's
hey, what...
I just
wanted to say something on that. Just to add something very quickly, I think that the old NSL, as far as I'm concerned, my personal opinion, was better standard. Mark might probably agree with me as that. You know, I think that the standard was much better as far as football, like Ivanovic, you could go on and on and on. But the A-League had better marketing opportunities, you know, when it kicked off. When I was part of that back in 2004 and 5, you know, I thought the marketing with John O'Neill and Matt Carroll and, of course, Frank Lowy. So Frank Lowy that was leading the light with the Red Letter Day. This is a Red Letter Day. I think that in terms of marketing, the A-League was better run in the early years with only eight teams, of course. Mm-hmm. But the old NSL had, as far as I'm concerned, you know, better standard playing.
We have an answer.
Mentally more complete.
Gentlemen, Mark, we have an answer for your question before about the victory man. This is from King Kenny from Melbourne. Danny Allsop, Melbourne Victory. Danny Allsop, was that him?
That's him.
That's him?
That's him.
Big boy, big giant kid. Big, I've stood next to him, actually. I know how big he is and how big he was. Exactly. Yes, Mark, you were going to say something.
Oh, yeah, I'm just going to just add a bit to that. I think the individuals that Roger just mentioned are so true. I was kind of what I was leading to. If you played an A-League side now, top four, top five, against a top four side back in the day, an A-League side would beat them because they just move the ball so much faster. They're so much fitter for obvious reasons because it's professional.
Yes. You're talking about guys in that league. They were semi-professionals. They had to come after work to train. They were so tired and exhausted. Then they had to get on, was it two or three times a week you guys trained, I think, in the NSL after work. Then you had to get on an aeroplane on Saturday morning, or was it Friday night, and play in the morning. Was that right? What was happening then, Mark, at the time? Were you guys being flown out and then you had to play on the same day, or did you have a rest day?
Well, we had a rest day. And but again, I just reiterate, the fitness level is absurd now. We just would not be able to compete. If you just look, if you just run a game alongside each other and look at the speed of the ball moving, it's unbelievable. It's such a comparison. It's so much faster now.
It is. It is. Tony, questions for Mark, or you want to say something?
I was trying to think of when we talked about the all the Adelaide City players earlier. You mentioned all that experience, and there's so much of that experience now, along with yourself, that we've lost, I think, especially at a top level of administration. And when the league was started back in 2003, that's, if you look at Northern New South Wales, obviously Newcastle and Central Coast had a great grounding. And if you look at the Northern New South Wales Association now, the amount of teams that are there, and the skill of those teams is exceptional. Are there, what teams from that area now are in the Australia Cup for this season?
I'm not sure, but I just came from an afternoon tea with a boy from played a game and won his game yesterday. But there would be heaps, like lots. You mean still
like Edgeworth, stuff like that? Because they're Broadmeadows, and all of those teams are outstanding teams.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. But it's in its infancy stage in terms of the rap here. So that, I mean, Coffs Harbour, Port Macquarie, there's that many different teams. Tamworth, they're still in it. If that's where you're. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, yeah. Yes. Yeah, because they put up a bloody good show, but they've got a good mix. I mean, a big, good mix. If you look at Adelaide, for instance, we've probably got, you know, probably four teams that are always exceptional, like, you know, your Adelaide cities, your metros and stuff like that, Campbelltowns. But if you look at those leagues, you've probably got six teams there that would compete with most other leagues in Australia.
Man, that's great that you raised that, because it makes me, what the first thing that springs to mind is, if I'm in a position where I could influence the new owners of the Jets, I would certainly be suggesting that part of the roster that they have five local players, like, and they have get paid good money, whether they're 15 years of age or 35 years of age. They staff would identify the talent. We wouldn't suggest that they pick the team, but give them the opportunity. If they don't make it and they don't make a debut with a 1 or 2 year contract, then they move on. But they move on, three move out, three move in. If we're ever going to get back to when the Knights play, they have 20,000 in the rugby league because of the Andrew Johnses and the boys that mix around drinking, getting drunk with locals, but they simulated with the locals. We're miles away from doing that. That's no disrespect to the coach. I think the coach and the Jets.
You have the thing. I'll tell you.
They need to be told, but you have to have five locals in your playing roster.
Yeah. What I want to ask you too is that you have such an asset in Newcastle, such an asset, and a neighbour of yours, of course. And you know who I'm talking about there. How'd you guess there, Mark? An asset of the game who is not doing much, not getting an opportunity to put into his special competition he wants to put together, like the Big Bash. You've probably heard it for many years. Is that right?
I have. He lives literally one block away. We have met together and we're close. And it's complicated. We just recently named the building after Craig at Spears Point at our $8 million sporting complex there. And it took a long time to get that. And at this point in time, things have come to a halt in terms of what Craig can do for the game in Northern New South Wales region for various reasons, and I won't go into it. But the reality is, maybe we've got to be big enough to help Craig help the game, but Craig needs help to help the game.
Yes.
I personally, I'm talking for myself now, because I've got to know Craig quite intimately, I understand his idiosyncrasies, and he's an inventor first. He's a highly intellectual man and quite complicated. We need to see through all that and then give him a gig and just say, this is what we're going to do for you. Here's some resources for you. Come on, let's make it happen. I think you'll find with Craig Johnson that he's ready to pull off a big one. He's waiting for the big one, and I think it's just around the corner.
And to me, it's just a waste that Football Australia do not contact him. I think he's the most decorated player. I think he's the most decorated player that has ever played first division. It was first division at that time. And whether you want to call it the Premier League 2, call it what you will, it was the best competition in the world. He is, in his mark, the highest decorated player, Australian player ever who's played overseas.
I think so. And not only that, this is his home. Whilst he was born in South Africa, but since he was about 2 years of age, two or three, he was raised right where our headquarters are, and that's where he kicked the ball against the wall there. So quite a remarkable history, and it'll either have a big bang or it'll be a very sad ending.
Have you heard anything? Is he doing anything with you guys? Is he want to do something with Northern New South Wales FA?
It's just at a standstill at the moment, shall we say.
Okay, so there's things, you're still working on it. Okay, Tony.
Carlos, already been.
What was that?
Now, the cost of playing football for many families, and the families, quite a vast. How can a Northern New South Wales make football registration more affordable to young families with 2 or 3, 4 children, for example?
It's a question I keep on asking, and I don't have the answers, to be honest. I'm trying to get it. It's a complicated thing, but I tell you what, it's under serious review. Trust me, it's like there's so much going into this now, like untapped resources in terms of Aboriginals, for example, Indigenous, to just go and play rugby league because it doesn't cost anything. I've had experience coaching country areas. My goodness, it's an untapped source. I strongly believe the mini Socceroos and representation, 17s, 19s, 20s, you know, the young Socceroos, let's say, it's not a true representation of our true talent, Australia, that's for sure.
Right. For example, I've just joined a 55-plus league. Registration is $420 for the season. That covers ground hire, referee fees, and lights, obviously, but from the $420, the club might be lucky to collect $30 at the end because you've got Northwest Sydney takes a cut, Football New South Wales takes a cut, FA takes a smaller cut, and insurance. So is the key to making football more affordable, more sponsorship, so the association could then, who sets the base fee, could then, or council takes a cut also because the ground hire. Is sponsorship of the game the key to making the game more affordable for many?
Probably, but I guess the media comes first before the sponsors, generally speaking, too. I mean, you know, I'm not sure how it works, but it's messy. The flow of money is, if you follow the flow of money, it can be alarming.
Mm-hmm. Now, of course, Angelo, you've got some more for... We're going to let Mark go very shortly because we've got a few issues we've got to talk about tonight too. We don't want to keep Mark on all night. Oh, boy, we've got a lot of issues, believe me. Angelo.
Yeah, no, just a very quick observation to what Mark is saying, and also Carlos brought an excellent point. You know, the cost of registering a player. For example, let me use Adelaide City. You know, my friend is on the board of management there. And let's say the fees are at $1,200 a year to register a kid. You know, you've got 600 kids. You know, that they raise something like $600,000-$700,000 from that. And that part of that money actually helps run the first team, you know, in the NBL. Mm. So this is the type of problem we have in Australia, whereas, you know, like I know, Harry, you've mentioned it more than once, you know, the fact that AFL, you know, like to register a kid, it costs something like $200,
$300. It's just unbelievable.
Yeah, and I think that is that what must be raised is a problem. It's an obstacle because it's been going on for the last 20 years. You know, we've got the highest participation of kids right up to the age of 14, 15, and we're sort of like asking for so much money from a family, especially when the fact of what Carlos mentioned, you know, if you've got three or four kids in the family and they all want to play football because, you know, if one plays, the other one wants to play, it's just not affordable. And we're sort of like shooting ourselves in the foot. I know it's an old saying, but it's a fact. And we've got to take opportunities, you know, like maximise the opportunities of the participation of the kids and turn it into a marketing strategy, a marketing tool to benefit the game, to grow the game, develop the game. I think Mark has mentioned that there are some obstacles there in northern New South Wales where you need to build a bit of unity. You need to unite. You know, he mentioned about so many associations with different constitutions. I mean, I know it's a big subject. We haven't got time to discuss it. But the first thing to do is to unite. And I remember when I was involved in Newcastle, Mark probably knows or he doesn't know, when Con Constantine was coach and Gary Van Egmond coach. But there was a guy called Richard Money who coached when I was there, and he played for Liverpool. He was the former Liverpool player, like Craig Johnston is. And, you know, in closing this, it's just a shame that the FA or the APL, I always mention both because I don't know what roles they're doing now, is we don't utilise enough our heroes like Craig Johnston, Tim Cahill.
Exactly. Harry
Kuehl. So on, you know. Jurelio Vidmaster, Milan Ivanovic is the, you know, there's hundreds of players.
I'll give you an example before I'll stop you there. I'll give you an example. When Real Madrid came here a few years ago with Ronaldo, right? They came out here, and of course, who was there? Who was their CEO and a popular man? Emilio Butragueño, a very famous Real Madrid player, and kids, were coming. You know that, Carlos.
The Vulture.
The Vulture, of course, and he was coming out here with the team, and he was talking all the time, and people were getting autographs. The parents are telling, did an autograph from Emilio. He's a great player, and all that. This is the thing: we don't have people with personalities or backgrounds to bring the people in as well. This is that when you've got a football player's background, you've got something there as well. Is it like an asset too, Angelo? You know that, don't you?
Well, look, let me add something that's very current. You know, the modern day thing. Vince Grella.
Yeah.
Who played with distinctly Empoli and Torino in Serie A. He's actually vice president at Catania.
There you go.
Where Pellegrini is one of his second teams. You got Zanetti, Javier Zanetti, who's vice president at Inter Milan. You know, you had Nedved at Juventus. You know, and you know, this is the type of thing that is a leading light. You know, it's a focus point to utilise and maximise. And they'd love to be part of it. I reckon these players are looking to approach like Johnson.
So it's such a valid point, and it goes without saying, it's so difficult to explain what the craft of the game can be manifested in administration role. It needs to be led in, our culture needs to be led by people that understand the craft of our game.
Yes.
It's very difficult to talk about the craft of our game with respect to an administrator, because they just really don't get it. So, yeah, like, why have we pissed off so many? Maybe it's just circumstantial, I don't know, but there's so many good untapped resources that we can get into and then really market our game. Because I would like to see us win a World Cup one day. I'd like to see us better. We're talking men, of course. We can talk about Sam Kerr if you like as well. But I'd like to see us, rather than being ranked 25th in the world, I'd just like to see us up in the top 10. Yes. And the only way we're going to do that is develop Goodwin, players like Goodwin. I don't know how your boy did it, but my God, he's the most technically gifted boy we have.
Exactly. Really,
in my opinion. Without, I don't think anybody comes close to him. So can we produce that? What is it? So if we can produce one, why can't we produce more?
Well, of course, we closed down the Centre of Excellence. Of course, it goes back to the administration saying, well, we're going to close this down and let all the A-League teams become the academies. How does that work? I mean, they've shown us nothing. This is where poor Gary Cole and I'm coming to you, Carlos. Poor Gary Cole and, of course, Ron Smith. I mean, they were just, I can't believe that they had to let them go. Carlos.
Look, in defence of the academy, we're now seeing a very exciting crop of youngsters through Sydney, Melbourne City and the like. So while looking back, probably the AAS was a wrong decision, but now we're now seeing the fruits of it. It takes 10 years to develop a player. Mm.
Yeah, good point.
You pick them up, you know, they show promise probably at 8, 9 years of age, and then you start the development. If they're not in the first team by 17, they haven't made it. And if they make it to the first team, like Sydney, Melbourne, or whoever, they have to be willing to make the sacrifices. And many people wish to party and not look after themselves. So Sydney FC is a classic example how the academy and the Wanderers, for as well, taking over 10 years. But now you have the youngsters coming. Sydney has sold over 5-10 players overseas. Jaspik is one. Nieuwenhof is the other one. And Adelaide, look at Adelaide. How many players have, Nistelrooy. But it takes 10 years for a player to develop if they have the aptitude and the willingness to work hard.
Good point, Carlos. I really think, you know, you've really made a point of what is so important and fundamental to Australia. And Mark mentioned as well, we've lost that career path, you know. And as you guys know, there's some players that I'm managing over here in Italy that, you know, like make a different choice now, different selection, you know. Let's go overseas, you know. But I think that in the past, we've had that beautiful career path that produced so many fantastic players that play. At one stage, we had like 70 players playing in England, you know, in the Scottish League, in Germany, you know, as long back as Mitchell that was playing there. And there's other players. Obviously, we could be here all day. But we had so many players playing in the Premier League and the Championship in Europe. Now, we could count them.
It's a trick.
Very few.
Yeah.
Very few. And not all of those players came through the Institute of Sport. Ron Smith, as you mentioned, Harry.
Yes.
You know, I just hope that FA revisit that idea.
There's something happening.
Reintroduce it.
It's got to be full time again, there, like it used to be. It has to be like an institution, not like a part time academy.
No way. It's got to be at a university, just like it was a university.
Live there. Yep.
University with a dorm and everything, stuff like that. That was the same in Canberra, of course. But I'm going to have to let you go there, Mark. Thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you. I love the shirt. Wait till you see my shirt, because that was your shirt too at some stage. So thank you very much for coming on, Mark. Thank you. Appreciate it big time.
One quick farewell. There's a company called iBrain that's I'd like to give a plug for awareness of that you'll get to know. You should Google it, Brain Eye or iBrain. I can't remember.
iBrain, yes.
And they have a mechanism where they can, it's a subscription to a telephone, and it gives you a yes or no, can just go straight on and test whether you've been concussed or should. It's scientific, it's medically backed by scientists. It's quite fascinating, and it's that cost-effective, cost a parent like $1 a month to have this on their phone.
That's worth it.
It's not complicated, but scientifically backed. It's called iBrain. It's worthwhile. Sure. And they could become a sponsor, Harry. That was my
A sponsor for the Footballers show. Let's talk to the. I'll talk to you, Mark, about that. Footballers sponsorship. We've got another sponsor that's come on tonight, but you might see that later on as well. That's the thing. Thank you, Mark, for joining us. We will talk again. We will talk with you again soon and see the outcome of what's happened in Northern New South Wales. That's it. We want to talk to you about some more too. Thank you very much, Mark. Thank you.
Good thing.
Thanks, bye.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. Thank you very much. Good on you, Mark. Guys, I think Marcus, that's if he just turn the button off, Mark, and that's it, basically. That's all. Okay, guys, I have to come on here right now because Angelo, you and me, I've been exchanging things with you, and those videos are a disgrace. There was kids at that game last week at Oakley. I'm absolutely, mate, that was, I've never seen the game that bad. And we're talking about a few weeks back, the same Oakley crowd caused trouble before that and they kept it quiet. This time they couldn't keep it quiet because it was on video. So what did you think of that? These bashings and things and bashings, a guy being knocked out on the ground. I mean, this is ridiculous.
Yeah, look, there was some things alike last night in the Champions League in Barcelona. They happened in the streets. But going back to what Harry was saying, we spoke off radio, off air, and, you know, I'm so disappointed. But I'd like to say that the game needs to be protected and defended at all costs. I think that these people that are causing these types of incidents are actually sabotaging the game, and they purposely go out there before the game. I don't think they plan it the day before. They plan it 2 weeks before. You know, and I think that these types of guys need to be eliminated, you know, stamped out of the game forever. There needs to be the highest penalty, as Craig said once, you know, he was right onto it. All the people that love the game don't like this sort of thing. I don't want to use the word hate because that's what we saw. Now, these guys demonstrate hatred. It's not about the game. It's not about passion. It's not about being entertained. It's not about going to see a good football game. It's about them, 2 weeks prior to that, organising thugs. They're just thugs.
Thugs.
And I think that...
If they're all hooligans from England and other places, the mobile phone has made a huge difference to organising the thuggery because it's instant communication. You could call for reinforcements. In the old days, you're going to have a fight. You'd be telephoning people to meet you around the corner for a fisticuff now, and you arrange it. But now with the mobile phone, it's instant communication.
Let me just say, let me just tell you guys what I've written here. When I was at, of course, I was down at Preston on Friday night, massive crowd. We'll talk about that crowd shortly. And also, I get this phone call. Harry, guess what, Harry? A friend of mine rings me up and says, there was a stabbing at Oakley. A stabbing? Really? Then they says, there was a gun, a guy with a gun, shooting a gun in the air. What is going on here? And then a guy being knocked out. Angela, I think you might have seen that video. A guy being kicked in the face, knocked out in front of all the crowd. What is this? And then there's two guys jumping the fence to save themselves because they were. There's a mob coming after them to grab them and bash them real good. They jump the fence in front of the referee and stop the game and everything. This is ridiculous. And there's kids there. The problem is there's kids. Is this what we're showing to the kids?
We're feeding and promoting hatred. And, you know, the media, as we know, we're lacking the media in a positive way. You know, we've got a lack of media conferences and, you know, all the beautiful things about the game. We're not getting any media space at all. And the media love this sort of thing. You know, the people that don't promote our game, they want to promote this sort of thing and say how ugly our game is. You know, and I think that really hurts me as a football enthusiast. You know, it really hurts me to see these sorts of things starting from, you know, when it started with the victory, you know, and now, and in these games, it's just such a delusional sort of disappointing thing. And I think that the clubs need to act straight away and just say, listen, these guys are not part of us. These guys are not part of us. And then the penalty needs to be a lot higher, a lot more hefty, you know, heavy sort of penalty. These guys stamp them right out of the game.
The other thing, Carlos, is you're a law. We could call you a law officer. You're a law officer. You know the laws. You know what has to be done. And what happened at Preston? I was saying to the people, if there was knives, I was talking to the officials. If they're bringing knives into the games, and they're going to stab someone, and they're setting all this up, right? The thing is, okay, it's time to put metal detectors there with security. Simple as that. And they're doing it at the A-League games. At the A-League games, they do it.
Look. I agree with Angelo that you have a moronic minority who are the whole purpose in their lives is to go out on the weekend and cause mayhem and disrupt. They're this, the game, the disruptors of the game. 98% of people who go to the game did not take knives, did not do stupid things. But the police needs to do their job to throw the book at them.
Or they got on the ground, the police, they escorted them around the ground and they put them straight in the cars.
And so, therefore, they need to be banned. You know, do we need to put metal detectors in suburban grounds? No, because 99% of people are there to watch the game. We need to weed out this moronic minority, and good football fans should be diving in this moron. It's like the flare, the people who throw flares. I know people say in Italy they throw flares in the street, but we're not Italian. We are, you go to England, it's a great atmosphere. We don't have to throw flares and cause me to have an asthma attack because I'm asthmatic and you didn't know when you threw the flare. So we need to stamp out this moron, lengthy bans, and criminal record. Because 99% of people are there for the benefit of the game.
Exactly. Now, Tony, it was pretty safe where you were on the weekend. Tell us about the game you were at. You were at which game was that? You spoke to me on the phone.
Yeah, I went to watch Raiders play against Olympic.
Yes.
And, it's funny. There was quite a few young lads at Raiders that I was quite impressed with, but they were probably the better side on the night, but they lost 1-0.
Oh.
So Olympic just didn't give up, obviously, and they managed to score that to the one that clinched it for them. But it was actually great. But the number of people at the ground was, as I showed you in the photos.
Yes.
But also on a Friday, they always do generally like a fish night, food night. Ooh. Their catering is exceptional. The number of people that they have at that under that stadium there, probably minimum 300, I reckon. Well catered for, lots of tables, very sociable. The bar's going, you know, flat out, drinks and all. But everyone works very hard there. They've got a lot of very good volunteers. But as you saw in the crowd, the car park was full. It's great to see. You know, when I go and watch Campbelltown play as well, the number of people that they get around the grounds and stuff like that, they're very healthy. You know, it's good. And I went to a Para Hills game the week before, and again, they are a very passionate crowd as well, and their car parks are very full. So it's great getting out to local NPL games and actually seeing the level of participation they got, because obviously a lot of the first team players are young lads, so their parents are going, and there's a lot of kids running around, obviously playing. So, that's actually great, you know, to actually go and see all these games. But I try to get to something different every week so I can have a really good look around. But it is enjoyable.
And you've got your accreditation, which means you can walk in relaxed and you can see whatever game you want to see and think about it and talk about it on the show, which you just did right now. Carlos, where were you? Anywhere. Tell us, where were you?
I was watching the Sydney FC game that 1-1.
Yes.
Good on Sunday, which was a 5 PM kickoff. It was a good time for a Sunday, good crowd. And Sydney did well to hold out for 10 men for 75 minutes against Brisbane Roar. And Robert Sankovic, ex Sydney FC and well credentialed coach, came home and great. Red in the 25th minute after a VAR review, and you knew once your referee went to the screen that there was only one outcome, early shower. But it was a great game, good crowd. Sunday afternoon, 5 PM, family friendly. This Sunday, I'm going to watch Rockdale Blackdown, 3 PM.
We want to know about that one. It's an NPL game. We're going to be showing a lot of NPL stuff shortly
and
too.
And Roger will come because Roger will only go to the 3 PM game.
I see. Yeah, so he's told me that Roger's going to get upset with you talking like that. He's going to get stuck into you now. Roger, ignore that, please. He's the Oracle, mate. You've got to respect him, you know, don't you? He's going to come back and say something. He's going to say something in a sec. You watch him. Oh, my God.
Yeah, we have a very good chats all the time and lengthy, really good really good conversation.
Fantastic. Now, I was at three games. Listen to this. Three games. I'm going to a fourth game tomorrow. I've lost a mate. Wow. They're calling me the soccer. I am really the soccer psycho now. The accreditations are making me go crazy, Carlos. I can imagine you going to the games with all this thing around your neck and everything. You're like the mayor of the game. You're like the mayor of the game, I think you are. The mayor of the game. That's it. And you, Tony, as well. You got the accreditation too, like from the football. Let's show. It's time Angelo went to a game and talked about a game too in Italy as well. See, we're going to ask you about a game next week too.
Oh, yeah. No, definitely. I've been to some of Napoli's home games. Unfortunately, Napoli's home record is very disappointing this
really?
Year. They've been losing lots of games. You know, they lost to Empoli as well, just to name a few. But I think I've been following Carlos. You know, he's practically married to football. You know?
He is. And, I know. The mayor of the game.
I was going to say that Tony now that's got the media pass and
exactly,
Harry.
Probably.
I'll be watching just to see how many games they'll be going to. But exactly. I know, well, Carlos, yourself.
Normally, I go and watch Sydney because it's just up the road from Double Bay, or an NPL game if Sydney's not playing. That's my one or the other. And then through NPL TV, like I was watching Beer. I'll go live. I'll try to see a game Saturday or Sunday live and then watch on the telly like Pony Dust. But looking forward to joining the 55.
Yeah,
and having fun.
Yeah, you know your knowledge is unquestionable. Like you mentioned the players' names and all that sort of thing.
Yes, he does.
But I just want to say one thing. 2 days ago, as I mentioned earlier, I was talking to Aurelio Vidmar about Steve Maxwell. Obviously, we had that friendship then, and I was talking to Aurelio about Melbourne City.
Melbourne City,
7-0 now. That's what I wanted to talk about.
Unbelievable.
Mark Rudan has been quite outspoken about the game, the fabrics of the game, you know, the status of the game. And, you know, he made 5 changes at halftime, practically changed half a team as though, you know, like some of these Champions League teams do, you know, like in the Serie A, you know, they play one team and then obviously in the Champions League another. But very, very disappointing from Western Sydney Wanderers. Mm-hmm. You know, that's certainly not going to promote, you know, the crowds because you know what they're like. They're quite fickle. You know, the crowd at Western Sydney. And, you know, it's quite disappointing. But a huge result for Melbourne City, who's got lots of injuries.
Massive. Oh, boy.
I mean, 3 games they have from... The Wanderers had the best defence in the league for the first 8 games.
But correct.
Also the lowest scoring ratio of any team. And now to go 3 games, coughing up 7-4-3, that's 14 goals. I think Marco Rudan's challenge is to resurrect the team because if he doesn't win, if he doesn't steady the ship in the next 2 games, him and De Mourinho will be on the way out.
It's already this afternoon. This afternoon it's on the news straight away. They want to get rid of him.
I haven't read, but it just seems to repeat itself every year.
It does.
Since Popovich left the Wanderers.
They want him now. The Wanderers, they want him back.
They haven't had success. And Popovich is a double coach that every year he will let 10 players go and bring 10 new players, the cut-off. Because the Wanderers would only give 1-year contract to players, maximum 2.
Boy.
But since he left, for whatever reason, they haven't found their mojo.
And, ever since Borrello's injury, they seem to have gone backwards. He was on fire.
Footage, but remember, besides Borrello, there's 9 other players around him and the goalkeeper, and the goalkeeper was totally exposed against Melbourne City with his childhood defending. It was kindergarten defending. But also, Aurelio Vidmar did his homework really well because he worked out weaknesses through the flank of the Wanderers.
Yeah.
And when play through the flanks, get the crosses in, quick transition, and see what it takes us. And everything went well for City, whereas in the other games, they dominated throughout the game, like Western United, but they haven't won the game. Like Napoli against Barcelona, there were 20 minutes that Napoli could have scored 5 goals against Barca. But just didn't happen. And then Barca goes bang, 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 and you're behind the 8-ball. So it is what it is. But it's a shame to the Wanderers. We need the Wanderers to do well and be competitive, but history seems to repeat itself by imploding in the second half of the season.
Okay, now I want to tell go on, Angela.
Just some quickly, sorry, Harry. You know,
right.
What Carlos said
got to finish.
Made me enthusiastic about the Western Sydney Wanderers, you know, the crowds they used to get. You know, I just wonder whether that affinity with the community and with the crowds has gone, you know, and it's sort of like drifting apart. And I think I'm not talking about the game now, the performance on the park, you know, perhaps the performance off the park, because they had the best crowds in the league.
They did. And they did.
Look, there's something about every time a club says we're going to build a new stadium, and Napoli is another one that's been floated that we're going to build a brand new stadium. And what Parramatta Park had, because it was old and historic, it had this like an emotional attachment. Once you went from 20,000 to 35,000, it appears to me you lost that. Intimacy of the ground, because you know, 10,000 the old stadium looked like sardines. 10,000 new stadium looked. So I do wonder where, when clubs build a new stadium, that intimate atmosphere and history is lost. And this is what happens, I think, to the Wanderers. A lot of people just the novelty factor wore off. They're not performing. They're not winning. So we're fickle people. We don't want to support losers. But also the bigger stadium, while it's amazing construction and state of the art, it's not. It doesn't recreate the same vibe.
That's right. But let me say, Tony. Let me tell you, Tony. At this game, and I'll tell you guys right now, I cannot still not believe how many people come to the AFL season started, and still there was 3,000 people at Preston versus Kingston City, and that was MPL2, and a great win by Preston 2-1 to, of course, Kingston City. 3,000 people. People are turning up to the games in Victoria. Listen to this one. I went on Saturday night too. Friday night was Preston. Then I went to MPL Hume City, only 10 minutes from me. They had 800 people. 800 people is reasonable for a Saturday night. They played Avondale. Avondale, which is in the second division next year. I met the coach. Mm. I spoke to him. We're going to have him on the show very shortly too. Fingers crossed. He's trying to organise something at his club. 2-1. And Sunday, you're not going to believe this. Monday was a holiday in Melbourne. And I said to myself, hang on, there's a game on 8:15 on Sunday night. Unheard of. And guess what? 1,000 people turned up to a game on Sunday night, and the weather was like 34 degrees at night time. 34 degrees. We were going. God. And this weekend was, as I said, all these days were like 30, and still they're turning up, and thank God they were night time. And St Albans Saints beat Moreland City 3-0. But Moreland City, the thing about Moreland City is they have to be the oldest club in Victoria at 106 years old, Carlos. Tony and
you get him on the show.
I've asked them to come on the show, but they've got their vote. They're actually doing right now. They're doing their voting for the next committee. So we can't do nothing until they get their new committee up.
I think we need to get Ken Morton from Tasmania.
I've spoken to Ken. Boys, let me tell you, I've spoken to Ken.
The last comment before we go to bed.
Last one. This is the last one. I'm sorry. Bedtime soon, guys. Don't forget this. 2 minutes. We've got only 2 minutes. Now, I've spoken to Ken Morton. You want to see this, Carlos? They are upset. Their association will not look after them going into the second tier competition or NSL2. And Ken is really upset. They're very upset. They're talking to get their vice president wants to talk to me on the show.
Yeah. End of the day, the club's voting the committee for Football New South Wales or Football Tasmania. That's how it works.
Yes.
We have an AGM. Okay, the chairman might be appointed by the board, but the board is elected by the members. So it's, you know, it's up to about time they stage a coup d'etat and turf out the old guard and have a myopic vision of football.
Exactly.
And get new people with a vision.
Exactly. Like getting the players back. Getting players back, like we said earlier. Get people who are football people. This is the thing. It's all business, business and money, business and money, business and money. That's all it is around the country at the moment, guys. Boys, thank you for joining me tonight. It's time to go to bed. I've got to go shopping, actually. I've got to go for my shopping. Anyway, guys, thank you for joining me. Always from Italy. Carlos from Sydney, South Australia, and this Tony as well. Guys, thanks for joining us. See you at the games tomorrow. I'll be at the games tomorrow. Western United in Melbourne Victory. Good night, guys. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thanks, guys. Cheerio to everybody out at Preston. See you next few weeks. Thanks, guys. Thank you for joining me. Hit it. What a great chat night again, guys. Here we go. Hup. Feel the rhythm, guys. People, hey. Hup. Good night, guys. Thank you for joining us. Don't forget, next Monday, we've got a big guest. I can't announce it yet, but we're still trying to get him. Here we go. Hup. Check it out. Hup. Hup. Feel it. Check it out right now, people. Here we go. Hey. Feel it. Hup.
The cup of life. This is the one. Now is the time. Don't ever stop. We should have known. Gotta be strong. We should have known right from the top. And when you feel the heat, the world is at your feet. No one can hold you back if you really want it. I see it in your eyes. You want the cup of life. Now that the day's here, you're gonna get it. Do you really want it?
Tell me right now, guys. See you on the weekend somewhere. Good night, guys. Thank you for joining me. See you very soon, guys. Next Monday, 8 p.m. Good night, guys. Thank you.